as the pleader's court, appearance was stated as it was.
May it please you, Your Honor, I appear for applicants 1, 2, and 3 as before.
May it please you, my lord, I'm still on record for applicant number 4 as before.
That's the court, this is my lordship, I appear on behalf of 5 and 6 as before.
Yes, Mr. Patel. Mr. Kamingala, you reminded that you are still under oath.
Yes, my lord.
I intend to deal with this document. It's also part of the state disclosure in the fiscal file. It's an affidavit of Mr. Bernard Venter. Yes, my lord. Good morning, Mr. Kanyangela.
Good morning, sir.
You will be aware of the document that I have just handed to you. Is
That's
that correct?
Correct.
You have received this document in your records. Is that correct?
Yes, correct.
Have to confirm that this is an affidavit of Mr. Bernhard Fente, who provides or states in paragraph 1 that he is a German citizen permanently residing in Namibia, a major male, chartered accountant, and a partner of Steel Fenter Associates, chartered accountants, who have the address, the place of business here in Windhoek. Would that be correct?
That is correct.
That he confirms in paragraph 2 that he's a chartered accountant and that he's a partner of Steel Fenter Associates Chartered Accountants.
Yes, correct.
He states in paragraph 3 of that affidavit regarding his understanding of the international standards of auditing. Is that correct?
Yes, correct.
And he says these are the auditing standards that help measure the quality of audits. Auditors review and report on the financial statements of companies according to the international standards of auditing. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And that they are tasked, that the auditors are tasked with determining whether the financial statements of companies follow the chosen accounting framework, which are accepted in Namibia. And currently, the following three accounting frameworks are accepted in Namibia: the International Financial Reporting Standards, B, International Financial Report Standards for Small and Medium-Sized Entities, and C, Namibian Statement of General Accepted Accounting Practice, capital N, capital A, capital C, 001, Financial Reporting for Small and Medium-Sized Entities. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And that auditors audit a company's financial information and accounting treatment to ensure they are consistent and comply with the applicable accounting framework being elected by the directors of the company. The Namibian Companies Act number 28 of 2004 requires that all companies in Namibia are audited by independent auditors. Is that correct?
Yes, correct.
And that international standards of auditing are a set of principles that auditors follow when auditing a company's financial statements. And they help to ensure the accuracy, consistency, and verifiability of an auditor's action and reports. And the international standards of on auditing are contained within three sections that cover general standards, field work, and reporting. Is that correct?
Yes, correct.
To that extent, he referred to the general standards, the standards of the field, and the standards of reporting. Is that correct?
Yes, correct.
That the auditor must, and I'm reading in the middle of that page, that the auditor must adequately plan the work and must properly supervise any assistance. It must obtain sufficient appropriate audit evidence by performing audit procedures to afford a reasonable basis for an opinion regarding the financial statements under audit. Is that correct?
Yes, correct.
He then, if we go to the following page, under paragraph 4, he explains how an auditor's report works. Is that correct?
Yes, correct.
And he talks about the components of this auditor's report.
Yes, correct.
He also talks about a qualified opinion, adverse opinion. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Can you read what he says under disclaimer of opinion?
He says a disclaimer of opinion means that for some reason the auditor could not complete the audit or chooses not to provide an opinion on the company. Examples can include when an auditor can be impartial or was not allowed access to certain financial information.
All right. Can you confirm what he states in paragraph 5?
In paragraph 5, he said, I further confirm that the National Fishing Corporation of Namibia, Fishcor, and its subsidiaries are our clients, in that our business has audited the annual financial statements of the company and group. Fishcor is 100% state-owned enterprise governed by the National Fishing Corporation of Namibia, 1991, Act Number 28 of 1991.
All right, you can stop there. Let's move on to paragraph 6. Is it correct that he talks about briefly the history of Fishco when it was founded and the subsidiaries of Fishco in that clause or paragraph 6?
That's correct.
When you look at the first three subsidiaries being Sea Flower Whitefish Corporation, Sea Scope Freezer Fishing, and Sea Flower Lobster Corporation, it would appear, or would I be correct, that in all those entities, Fishco holds majority stake in those entities?
That's correct.
And Sea Flower Pelagic Processing, it's a joint venture where Fishco only has 40% and African Selection Fishing Namibia has 60%.
That's correct.
All right. He stated in paragraph 7 that he can provide the audited financial statements of Fishco and its subsidiaries for the periods from 2010 and 2011 financial year all the way to 2017-2018 financial year. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And he has annexures that he had referred to, which would be SV3 to SV10.
That's correct.
And he states that the subsidiaries have been audited by his firm, Steve Fenter Associates, for the years indicated above, except for the entity where Fishco has a minority stakeholding, being Sea Flower Pelagic Processing. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Which was not audited by his firm, and which they have no financial statements for those years.
That's correct.
He then confirms in paragraph 8. What does he say there?
He says, I am aware of the agreement signed between the National Fishing Corporation of Namibia Limited and the Ministry of Fisheries and Marine Resources when the National Fishing Corporation of Namibia became a designated entity to administrate the quotas awarded for governmental objectives.
All right. He talks about the statements, the annual financial statements of Fishco in paragraph 9. You are aware of that?
Yes.
Can you read to the Honorable Court what he says in there?
He said the annual financial statements of Fishco are prepared from information provided by the management and the board of directors of the Fishco group and are only reflecting the quotas granted to the group, which are for the benefit of Fishco and its subsidiaries, as was presented to us by the management of the group and confirmed by the Minister of Fisheries and Marine Resources in his annual confirmation letters. Together with the audited financial statements of Fishco, Steel Fender Associates has prepared from documentation and information provided by the management the confirmation of the third-party quota granted through the National Fishing Corporation of Namibia, Fishco, and confirmation of beneficiaries. I now provide the records of those governmental objectives confirmation, see annexures SV11 to SV14. The confirmation SV14 was handed to the then acting Minister of Fisheries and Marine Resources, Dr. Abed Kawana, on 15 January 2020, who has not signed the confirmation until now.
What does he say about the reason for the preparation of the confirmation of the third-party quota granted through the National Fishing Corporation and confirmation of beneficiaries in paragraph 10?
He said the reason was that the chief executive officer of Fishco, Mr. Mike Nyuponya, would receive direct instruction from the former Minister of Fisheries and Marine Resources, Mr. Bernard Esau, to sell the governmental objective quotas on behalf of the government of Namibia, and the minister provided instructions on how to distribute the income and from such sale. Fishing quotas granted to the Fishco group can be divided in four different categories. 10.1, quotas granted to Fishco for the benefit of Fishco and its subsidiaries as commercial quota, being the normal share of Fishco in the commercial allocation of the TAC, total allowable catch, of a specie of marine resource. The proceeds from these quotas are recorded as income in Fishco and its subsidiaries. Quotas granted to Fishco as governmental objective quota, where the Minister of Fisheries and Marine Resources decided that Fishco will be the beneficiary of such governmental objective quota, in terms of the designation and cooperation agreements between the Ministry of Fisheries and Marine Resources in Fishco. The proceeds of these quotas are recorded in the annual financial statements of Fishco and its subsidiaries, as Fishco is the ultimate beneficiary of these quotas. Quotas being granted, 10.3, quotas being granted to Fishco, where Fishco acts as an...
Let me help you so that we can exchange to make it easy for both of us. I'll read some portion and then you confirm, and in some instances I'll ask you to read. So if I can just help you there. He says, quotas being granted to Fishco, where Fishco acts as agent for the Ministry of Fisheries and Marine Resources, an administrator of these quotas on their behalf. These quotas were administered in Fishco in two different ways as specified under paragraphs A and B below. And these quota transactions will not reflect in the annual financial statements of Fishco or its subsidiaries. A, Fishco is selling the quota on behalf of the Namibian government or the government of Namibia and collects the proceeds of such quota sale. The proceeds are then utilized to pay government objective expenditure as per instructions of the then Minister of Fisheries and Marine Resources, Mr. Bernard Esau, as per the terms of the designation agreement between Fishco and Ministry of Fisheries and Marine Resources. Is that correct? The proceeds of the quota directly to beneficiaries as per instructions of the then Minister of Fisheries and Marine Resources, Mr. Bernard Esau. This means Fishco is not handling any finance for these objectives, government objective quotas. Is that correct?
That's correct.
He then says only quota sale transactions from point 10.1 and 10.2 above will be reflected in the annual financial statements of Fishco and are covered by the audit report of this AFS of Fishco, annual financial statements of Fishco and its subsidiaries. The transactions described under point A of paragraph 10.3 are recorded in the accounting records of Fishco, but are, however, not reflected in the annual financial statements of Fishco and its subsidiaries, as Fishco acted as an agent of the Ministry of Fisheries and Marine Resources for these transactions. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Would this tie down with the designation agreements that we dealt with yesterday?
That's correct.
All right. Therefore, these transactions are not covered by the audit report of the annual financial statements of Fishco and were therefore separately confirmed by the former Minister of Fisheries and Marine Resources, Mr. Esau, as true and correct government objective transactions. Transactions described under point B of paragraph 10.3 are outside the financial records of Fishco and were not subject to any audit procedures. Hence, these were included in the confirmation of the quotas being granted and approved by the then Minister of Fisheries and Marine Resources, Mr. Esau. Is that correct?
That's correct.
He then deals with, he continues under paragraph 10, if you look at the following page, page 9. Is that correct?
That's correct.
What does he say about, in the bolded part of that paragraph?
He said, Mike Nipunya, CEO of Fishco, and his management would identify the said governmental objective transactions for confirmation of the third-party quota granted through the National Fishing Corporation of Namibia, Fishco, and confirmation of the beneficiaries thereof.
Would it be fair to say his management refers to the management of Fishco?
That's correct.
Not only Mr. Ngipunya was giving this information to the auditors, so other officials of Fishco would also give information to the auditors.
That's correct.
So it would not be fair to say only Mr. Mike Ngipunya was giving auditors the information. Would that be correct in saying that?
With regarding to the compiling of the financial statement of Fishco, yes.
Yes. All right. He then says, but we are talking about what he stated in that paragraph. He says, Mr. Mike Ngipunya, CEO of Fishco in bracket, and his management would identify the said governmental objectives, transactions for confirmation of the third-party quota granted through the financial, the National Fishing Corporation of Namibia, and confirmation of the beneficiaries thereof. So more than one person, according to that statement, gave information to these auditors. Would that be correct?
I will still stick to the answer just I gave you a few minutes ago.
All right, but the auditors here, if we look at what this paragraph says from Mr. Fente, my understanding that it was not only Mr. Ngipunya, but his management as well would identify the said transactions would be correct.
I cannot explain such. This is not my statement. I don't know what he meant by this paragraph.
But that's what he says there.
That is what he said.
That Mr. Ngipunya and his management would identify these transactions.
You are correct.
All right. He then says, Stephen Associates prepared summaries of the transactions being provided by Fishco management to be confirmed with the signature of the then Minister of Resources. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Importantly, what does it say about paragraph 11? What was the purpose of all this exercise?
Paragraph 11, it says, the cooperation and designation agreement being published in Government Gazette 6017, dated 17 May 2016, Annexure SB 15, are the only agreements governing governmental objectives we are aware of. The governmental objectives are explained in the designation agreement, paragraph 3.1. The governmental objectives income and expenditure has been audited in terms of the cooperation and designation agreements. In the ultimate audit, evidence for correctness of the transactions was obtained by receiving a signed confirmation from the then Minister of Fisheries and Marine Resources, Mr. Bernard Esau, that these transactions were directed by him. As per our understanding of the designation agreement, Fishcoal was appointed as agent to the government of Namibia. And therefore, the governmental objective transactions were outside the normal operations of Fishcoal and its subsidiaries, and consequently not disclosable as Fishcoal transactions. Only after the Minister of Fisheries and Marine Resources, Bernard Esau, resigned as Minister, certain governmental objective transactions directed by him became suspicious. And this was highlighted to the then Acting Minister of Fisheries and Marine Resources, Dr. Albert Kawana, for further investigation and confirmation. Until now, we did not receive any feedback on these transactions from Honorable Dr. Albert Kawana and his ministry.
All right. Not this affidavit he admitted as an exhibit. Mm-hmm. Tempted to suggest that it will be exhibit double E.
Yeah, I just want, you see, because you stop halfway. And human nature being what it is.
Yes.
I was reading the...
That's what I always do, my lord. I leave something to tantalize the interest of my colleagues. I know you'll move into it. But, my lord, the areas that I wanted to rely on for purposes of that
traverse okay. Double business. Exhibit EE. Yes, I have admitted it.
Yes, my lord, I'm just thinking now of my next move.
Oh, okay.
Yes, I'm just trying to think on my feet again.
I'm sure you had your coffee before you came.
Yes, I did, my lord. I did, my lord. Thank you so much for affording me the opportunity.
You are well to continue.
Yes. Yeah. My instructions, Mr. Kayangela, are as follows. That the auditors were independent, external auditors of the company, performing an independent auditing or verification exercise of the affairs of Fishcoal. And by the auditors, I mean these Steel Fenter Associates. Did you understand my question?
No, I understand.
Yes. And that they were independent so that they could assist the minister, the board, or anyone with the transparency of the affairs of Fishco pertaining to governmental objectives, quota, and other business affairs of Fishco.
Yes.
And my instructions are that the auditors had the full powers and ability to contact anyone to obtain information which they sought in the process of the auditing of both the affairs of Fishco, but specifically the governmental objectives quota and its management.
But that can be because I don't know the power that was granted to them.
All right. The power of the auditors is pretty common. It's available in the Companies Act. I can direct you to those provisions. But it's not helpful at this stage.
I don't have any
yes.
knowledge of auditors.
All right.
So even if you...
All right.
I will not understand that.
All right. No problem, sir. This statement of Mr. Fente was commissioned by an official of the ACC. Is that correct?
That's correct.
It was accepted or commissioned by a Mr. William Olivier. Is that correct?
That's correct, yeah.
Was there any subsequent further request for information from this gentleman or from these auditors for provision of further information by the ACC?
I cannot really confirm that.
But you cannot deny that
because
there was no further
Mr.
information.
Because Mr. was the one who was dealing with them.
Yes. But we can accept that in view of the statement, the only statement that has been provided, we can accept that there was no further request for further information.
I cannot conclude that.
All right. You see, it seems like in some instances, we are running into a cul-de-sac because you testified earlier that Mr. Olivier and Mr. Clute, they were your subordinates at the office, at the ACC, is that correct?
That's correct.
You were supervising their work?
That's correct.
During this investigation?
That's correct.
And their work in this instance would also include this affidavit because it came in the course of their work. Is that correct?
That's correct.
The work that you supervised.
That's correct.
So you make it very difficult for us when you disown or plead ignorance about what happened.
No,
why do you do that? Because you were supervising their work.
I have already informed you that. I've been dealing with a lot of documentations. That
yes.
case is having a lot of documentations. Yet you could not accept me to know every document in the case file.
Yes, I do, unfortunately.
The disclosure was done. If there was
yes.
any information or additional information, you could pick it up.
So we will say that it will be fair to argue that in view of the fact that in the disclosure, this is the only document from Mr. Fenter, there was no further request by the ACC.
I could not conclude that, yes, I said.
All right.
There was no further request by the ACC?
Yes, for further clarification from Mr. Fenter. Yes. My instructions are also, and we were dealing with this when we were looking at, maybe I should refer you to the page, I think it was page 20277, those letters, audit letters, my lord,
okay.
of yesterday.
It's page 71.
Yes, one was in page 71.
So 60.
295, my lord.
Yeah.
298. Mm-hmm. I'm just quickly checking which bundle it was.
The Z bundle.
For For example, if you look at page 71 of the state's bundle.
Yes, I'm there.
Yes. These auditors, as we have checked yesterday, they would themselves independently write to the minister. Is that correct?
That's correct.
In fact, when they sought a response from the minister, they said, you can confirm directly to us as the auditors. Is that correct? If you look at the third paragraph from the bottom.
That's correct, yeah.
You can confirm directly to us, Steer Fenter Associates, Chartered Accounts, Accountants, and they also presented their email in there.
That's correct.
Which they sought the minister to report directly to them.
That's correct.
I'm instructed that this is the common practice for auditors, that where they want to verify certain information from external parties, they do so and they seek to receive the reports directly themselves. Those are my instructions. And that's why they wanted to receive the emails directly, but not through Mr. Ngepunya or Fishco. Those are my instructions.
No, I cannot deny that.
Yes. I'm also instructed that the external auditors, when they communicate with these external parties outside of the company, these are called external confirmation procedures, and the auditor maintains control over external confirmation requests, and the management of the company does not play a role in that process. Once the external auditor directly engages external parties. Do you have a comment to that?
Are you reading from somewhere? Or?
No, I'm just telling you my instructions.
I'm not against that instruction.
All right. I'm also instructed that if the auditor, in the course of engaging with the external parties, identifies factors or reasons that give that auditor doubts about the reliability or correctness of the information sought or the responses, the auditor has the power to obtain further evidence to resolve those doubts. These are my instructions.
Yes, I can take them as they are.
Yes. In fact, I'm instructed that in this instant, email or letter that we have just looked at page 71, the minister sought, or the auditors sought, a positive confirmation from the minister whether he had, you know, taken those decisions and that they were executed to his instructions.
That's correct?
Yes. Based on this information that you obtained yourselves from the Ministry of Fisheries and Marine Resources and also from Fishco pertaining to these audits, I'm looking at the one on page 72. I just am giving you an opportunity to comment. My Lord, that is my cross-examination. And thank you, Mr. Kanyangela, for answering my questions. As he pleases the court.
Applicant number six, Mr. Philippus Mapopi. And my duty today is that basically to cover some issues with you in order to secure the release of my two clients. Furthermore, I also extend what already had been extended yesterday by my learned colleague on behalf of applicant number four, that you must follow my questions, and if you are not in a position to do so, to inform us accordingly, or if you don't understand the question, also to inform us as such. Can we have that arrangement?
Yes, we can have that.
So let's start off with During your testimony, more particular in chief, you informed us that prior to you joining the ACC, that you were a member of the Namibian police, more particular the commercial branch. Is that so?
That's correct.
And during the time that you've been attached to the commercial unit, have you attend any specialized investigation course more pertaining to how to investigate crime scenes, crime-related matters?
Not particularly on crime scenes, but I attend an advanced course on how to investigate fraud-related matters.
While you're in that particular school, can you then also inform me, was one of the courses or one of the subjects or one of the coursework that you have done is when you come to court to reveal all information to the court in order for the court on the facts to make an informed decision?
That's correct.
Okay. So, just a matter of interest first. Before you come and testify, more particular when applicant number 4, number 5, and number 6 have testified, have you watched the live broadcast before you come and testify?
I was not following those.
Do you have not watched it?
No.
So, okay. Let's start off with, what I will try to do with you is that I will more concentrate on the issues pertaining to applicant number 5, that is Mr. Ortner.
Yes, correct.
Do you know what is the charges that he faced according to the indictment?
Yes, I know some of the charges.
Can you also share that with us, please?
I know contravention of Section 46 of the Anti-Corruption Act. I can recall Section 35 of the same Act. I think so far I can recall those two.
Okay. You also, when you start off with your testimony, evidence in chief, provide certain reasons why you're opposing bail. But I put it to you that it was more in a general sense. I want you to confine you to applicant number 5. What is the reason that you oppose bail for applicant number 5?
Who's applicant number 5?
Mr. Ortner.
Okay.
It will be the same reason I gave in my evidence in chief.
So would it be then?
The same reasons.
That it's a flight risk, that he may interfere with police investigation as well as state witnesses, that he would abscond, and that you have a strong case against him, and that it will not be in the interest of the public or administration of justice if the applicant be released on bail.
At least that you say, except that you say he interfered with the police investigation.
We will come to that. Applicant number 5, he testified before this court. And he have placed the following before this court. He testified that he is a Namibian citizen, sir. Would you dispute that?
I'm not disputing that.
Furthermore, he also testified that he lived in Namibia for his whole life. Would you dispute that?
I won't dispute.
Furthermore, that his family is also staying, residing in Namibia. Would you dispute that?
I don't dispute.
You also testify that you have a strong and emotional ties and roots in the Republic of Namibia.
I don't dispute that.
Furthermore, sir, can I ask you, what is the purpose of bail?
The purpose of bail?
Yes.
The purpose of bail is to release somebody from detention pending the trial.
Okay. And what is the purpose or what is the reason that you arrest somebody in general?
The reason is to bring the person to court or before court.
And you also agree with me that's another method that can be used by way of summons, that you can secure the attendance of any person before court. Is that so?
I'm aware of that.
So is it also so, or can you dispute the fact that applicant number 5, residing in Otsivarongo, more particular at 3221 extension 16 Otsivarongo?
Yes, he's staying there.
You also agree, that's what they have testified, that the nearest police station to his house is the Otsivarongo police station?
Yes, that could be the nearest police station.
How many police stations is in Otsivarongo, sir? Because you told us that you have stationed for a certain point in time in Otsivarongo.
I only know 2.
Okay. The applicant, number 5, also testified that if the court is of the view that he can be released on bail, that he offer or tender amount of 50,000 Namibian dollars with certain bail conditions that the court can attach to his release. That was his testimony.
Yes, that was his testimony.
He also testified that at the end of the day, that he would come back to court in order to stand his trial.
That is what you think, yes?
He also testified under oath that he will adhere to any bail conditions of which this honorable court deemed fit if he been released on bail.
Yes, that is what he papers.
Okay. So prior to applicant number 5 being arrested, had you engaged at any particular point in time with applicant number 5?
Prior to his arrest?
Yes.
Yes, I do have engaged with him.
And if you can recall, on how many occasions?
I know I engaged him face to face on 2 occasions.
Yeah, and
sometimes we engage each other through cell phones.
Okay. But can you, maybe perhaps, that is important, when was the first time that you engaged him face to face?
The first time was on the 11th of June, 2020.
And at which town or place?
It was at the Anti-Corruption Commission Office headquarters.
That is now situated in Windhoek.
That's correct.
And the applicant drove all the way from Otsivarongo to come and see you for the interview.
That's correct.
Was there any other interview that he attended in Windhoek?
Not the one I'm aware of.
But he have testified before this honorable court that he also attended an interview on the 26th of June, 2020. Would you dispute that?
I will dispute that.
Furthermore, he also testified that he attended a meeting with you on 13 and 14 October for an interview in Otsivarongo.
That's correct.
So that one you don't dispute?
I'm not disputing it.
Is it also so? And in which year was that?
2020.
Okay. Do you know when the accused person, applicant number 5, had been arrested?
I think he was arrested on the 21st of December 2020.
The applicant have also testified that during June, more particular on the 11th of June, have already been informed that time there is a suspect in this particular matter, sir.
Yes, he was informed on that particular day. I'm not disputing that.
Furthermore, he was also informed They're daring to interview in October, 13, 14 October. There is a 2020. There is a suspect in this matter.
That's correct.
Just for the record, to place it on record, do you agree with me that applicant number 4, number 5, and number 6 is only being charged when it comes to the fish core matter?
And who are?
The fish core file. Mike, Oti, Mapopi.
That's correct.
Can you give us the surrounding circumstances? How did it happen that applicant number 5 been arrested? What happened?
How it happened? I know there was a warrant of arrest that was applied against him.
Do you know the date of that warrant?
It could be the 12th of December 2020.
Okay. When was the first time that a state, when I'm referring to the state, ACC or the Namibian police go public in order to secure or trace applicant number 5?
I'm not aware whether there was such to go on public for his arrest.
Was there any newspaper articles, television, that he's a wanted man?
Not the one I'm aware of.
Are you sure, sir?
I say I'm not aware whether there was such.
Okay. Now, applicant number 5, while he was in that box, undisputed, he have not been challenged, informed this honorable court that on the 14th of December 2020, the state prosecutor, Mr. Lutubesi, informed us publicly that number 5 also been joined in this particular matter, and that all this information with a photo of him was all over the media as well as the social media. Would you dispute that?
I'm not aware of that. But I know the decision that was given, it was given on that date.
Okay. Who have made that decision?
It's the PG's office.
The PG's office.
That's correct.
In order for accused applicant number 5 to be arrested.
That's correct.
And then the instructions have been followed through. Is that so?
That's correct.
Do you know the date of the arrest of applicant number 5?
It was just the date I mentioned to you.
That was?
The 21st of December, 2020.
And the police arrested him?
I cannot confirm just how he was arrested, because when he was arrested, I was on leave. I was not in the office.
You testify?
You came with them, is what I understood.
You testify that he make himself available freely, voluntarily, on the 21st. The 21 December 2020, he reported himself with counsel of record at the office of ACC. Would you dispute that?
I'm not disputing that.
Now, let me put it to you. Is that not a good sign of somebody that is willing to face his trial and willing to stand his trial? He make himself available to the authorities.
He can pretending to do such.
Pretending.
Yes.
Why do you say he pretend?
He would like to see, to have been seen good, to see that at least he can be trusted.
Okay. And he can also be trusted. Because on 3 occasions, when he has been called, while he was in Otsifarongo, on 2 occasions, came all the way to Windhoek and make himself available. That is indeed a sign of somebody that is honest and can be trusted.
By that way, he was not aware of the charges that were made against him.
You have already informed us that in June and during October, it has been informed that he's a suspect, sir.
Yes.
So therefore, there was ample time for him
to run off, to disappear. Is that so?
To be told that you are a suspect is not just something that you can say, let me run away.
Okay. What is a suspect, sir?
It's somebody who is suspected.
And he can be arrested any given time?
That's correct.
While that, with that information, knowledge, he's still, even in October, come back to you in Ichofarongo, sir.
That's what for I say. Second he was time. Not aware as what evidence does the state have against him.
Okay. You also agree with me that applicant number 5 was one of the last 2 persons that have been arrested in this particular matter.
That's correct.
All other co-accused persons was already in custody.
That's correct.
So based with that information, you know that other people has already been arrested. You could have disappeared. Is that so?
If he knew what could also face himself.
Okay, I will argue that point. So, just a matter of interest, was any of the accused persons in this particular matter being released on bail?
Not yet.
Do you know a certain Mr. Ricardo Gustavo?
We are on the fiscal matter.
No, sir. I was specific when... Let me put it this way. Was any of the accused persons that faced charges before this high court, in this particular court, being released on bail?
That's correct.
And what is the name of that person?
It's Ricardo George Gustavo.
And you also agree that he's accused number 1 in this particular matter?
That's correct.
Let's deal with the issue of interference. Do you have any objections on that particular score pertaining to applicant number 5?
Yes, I do have an objection.
Now let's deal with the facts. You already testified that 11 June 2020, the applicant number 5 was interviewed by the ACC.
That's correct.
You also agree that they've been arrested during December 2020.
That's correct.
Now, let me ask you like this. From June up to December, it accused applicant number 5 in any way interfere with your witnesses?
He did not, because by that time I don't know whether he was aware of who were the witnesses.
The applicant number 5, from June up to December, when he'd been arrested, interfere with police investigation?
He did not.
Furthermore, from December, date of arrest, up to May 2021, when he received disclosure, it interfere with police investigations?
Not what I'm aware of.
The applicant number 5 interfere with any state witnesses from arrest up to date of disclosure, May 2021?
May 21. From the date of arrest until May 21, I could only recall as to how he communicated to one of the witnesses, who is Mr. Kamano.
Was it before or after his arrest, sir?
I cannot confirm whether it was before or it was after.
No, when counsel for applicant number 4 was dealing with the issue yesterday, he read that statement, sir, and yes, according to under correction, paragraph 50 or 51, it was prior to his arrest, sir. So, not while he was in custody.
You said you are for
5 and 6.
Yes, that's Mr. Sudifonia.
Yes. The name that had been made reference to is Oti.
Can you direct us to...
There is Z23.
Yes.
Paragraph 48.2.
Yeah, that's all done.
Do you have a copy of the statement, Z23, sir?
Yes, I do have a copy.
Yes. You see paragraph?
It's page 14, underneath paragraph 48.2. It is not marked, but I receive Mr. Engelbrecht banking details through a WhatsApp message. You got that paragraph, sir?
Yes, I see the paragraph.
Was it now before or during the time that he was in custody?
Whom are you speaking about, Mr.? Just because, you see, because at this point, Mr. Ngipunya was, this is testimony about Mr. Ngipunya who was communicating from, with. So just be clear whom you are speaking to and at what period you are speaking.
Let me rephrase, sir. Applicant number 5 interfere with any of the witnesses before his arrest.
Before his arrest, he communicated with this witness.
How do you know that, sir?
It is indicated in the statement.
There's no date in that statement, sir.
Maybe we'll have to relook at it. I see some dates there. Where is it? The messages were sent on 21 and 27 November 2020.
Paragraph 50, sir.
That's correct.
He said, I receive another phone call from OT again. Ask where we can meet up. You got that?
Yes.
Which means that he was outside.
Yes, he was outside.
So that's therefore, correct. He have not interfered while he was in custody.
That's correct.
And furthermore, at that particular point in time, this witness has not yet made a statement, sir. This witness only make a statement in December 2020 and at a time, just even 2 weeks before Mr. Ote has been arrested. Is that so?
That's correct.
So at the time, he was not aware that this person would be a potential witness. Is that so?
I cannot confirm that.
Okay. Now let's...
Your Lordship, is that an instruction? His client was not aware this was a witness. Or is it a statement just being put?
Yeah.
Let me put it to you. When was Mr. Oti arrested? A day before? A day after the statement has been made. Is that so?
Can you repeat the question again?
Do you know when applicant number 5 was arrested, sir?
I think I have already informed you.
What was the date, sir?
21 December 2020 is what I said.
When was this statement of this witness? When did he make this statement?
It was 9 December 2020.
Was he aware at the time that this person would be a witness?
Who is that one?
Applicant number 5. Was he aware at the time that this gentleman, Jose, would become a witness? Was that information known
to him? He could be aware that he could be a witness because we questioned about him on the transaction that was made between him and the company.
Okay, sir. What is also strange is that while applicant number 5 was standing there, in the witness box where he was testifying, there was no counterclaim by the state that he had interfered while he testified and said he had not interfere with any state witnesses at the time, up to the time of his arrest, arrest and even up to date.
I was not there when he was testifying.
Okay. Let's proceed. From the time of the arrest of applicant number five, let me put it this, from the time that he has received the disclosure, May 2021, up to date, applicant number five interfere with police investigations.
Not.
Applicant number five, from date of disclosure up to date, interfere with any of your witnesses.
You did not.
So what is the current status as far as the investigation of the Fishkor matter? Is it completed, ongoing? What is the status?
The investigation is completed.
So you have obtained all the statements from your witnesses?
That we have identified, but if there's anything, information that are coming up, we can still follow up such information. We cannot ignore such.
Okay. So, when the decision has been made in order to arrest applicant number five, why have you not called him or sent him an email in order to make himself available? Because that information, his cell phone number and his email address, was known to you.
I said when the decision came out, I was on leave, and I don't know how he was being handled by those who arrested him. So I don't know what was communicated and what was not communicated to him.
Before the arrest of applicant number five, was he employed, sir?
Yes, he was employed.
And what is the position currently?
His position currently, I don't see he's having a position.
Okay, sir. Why do you say so?
My understanding is that he had been removed from the payroll of the way he was employed.
Okay. Have you been dismissed?
I'm not aware of his dismissal.
Do you have any letter, any proof thereof?
I don't have such.
He has testified indeed before this Honorable Court and said that he has received his last salary this year at the end of July, sir.
I cannot.
We are not that. Yet in July. We are not yet in July. We are only in February now.
He testified before this Honorable Court that indeed his salary has been stopped. Do you know anything about that?
I don't know what you have testified.
But you testified that his salary has been stopped.
No, no. He said he has been removed from the payroll.
Okay. So what is your understanding, being removed from the payroll? Do you still receive a salary?
You are not receiving.
And when was that?
I think I read it in the newspaper this year.
So you don't have any proof even to that effect?
But I know I read about it.
So but you don't have any proof that he has been fired, that he has been dismissed?
I don't have such proof.
So therefore you cannot make the statement that you have made during your evidence in chief that he's unemployed, that you don't know. Is that so?
I might say that he's unemployed.
Sorry? I didn't hear you. I just want you to be louder.
I said if I did testify in my evidence in chief that he is unemployed, I gave referring to myself to the Public Service Act, which indicates that if a person absent himself from duty for a period of more than 30 days, he will regard it as is discharged from the work.
And you also agree with me that that is also subjected to the fact that he just disappear, and if his workplace, his workstation is not aware about his whereabouts at that particular point in time. He's in custody.
Yes, he's in custody, correct.
Okay. Let's move on. You also, do you know perhaps how many witnesses would be called in order to come and testify whenever this trial commences?
I know the witnesses are more than 300.
So after the joint application, we have been informed that indeed it is 338 witnesses that the state intend to call as it stands, sir.
That can be possible.
Now, according to you, sir.
What, 300?
300.
All right.
338 witnesses after they joined the application, sir.
That's correct.
Now, according to you, the length period of this particular trial, could you estimate for how long?
I have already testified that the length of the trial can depend as to how this case is being handled in court and the circumstances.
Yes. And that circumstances would also depend whether or not there's interlocutory applications, and there would be trials within a trial, and each of whatever CPA, ACC sections to be challenged, the constitutionality thereof. That's so you correct. Don't know. And you want applicant number 5 and 6 to stay in custody for this whole time up to the time of the finalization of his trial.
I could not foresee the things that we have just now mentioned. If they are coming up, that's why I say it depends. It was the circumstances of the case, how it is being handled in court.
But you agree with me that at least, based on the witnesses as it stands, it will at least last 3, 4, 5 years.
I have indicated to this court that although they saw such a number of the witnesses, most of the witnesses, they only gave confirmatory statement of the service they either rendered or of the payments that they have been received in this matter, and they may not take long time in the witness boxes.
But that you don't know, because there can be a dispute about payments, bank account numbers, so that can take at least, maybe, we don't know for how long.
Then I can
that is
also
pure speculation.
I can also
your
say is how long will it take.
Yes. So the statements that you have obtained from your witnesses, that statement is indeed under oath. Is that so?
That's correct.
Because the reason why I pose that question to you is that you testifying your evidence in chief, that accused person can convince some of the witnesses to change the content of the statements.
It's something that happened already with the cases we dealt with.
Which case are you referring to?
I'm referring to the case of a certain Mr. Dirhart. It was a Shuarongo case.
Okay. So we're talking about this case to give any evidence to that effect, anything under oath?
The accused persons are still in custody, and the trial did not yet start. Hence, I cannot say there was any witnesses who have changed his statement or the version of the statement.
And there's also, you cannot also come and testify with certainty today that indeed they will change the statements because it's under oath.
The statement that the case I referred to, it was also for the same statement that were given under oath. But when the people came to court, they changed their statement. They changed their views of the statement.
So as you stand now, sir, it is just pure speculation. You don't have any statement under oath in order to qualify your statement.
I don't know which statement under oath you are referring to.
That he will come and change his versions in order to suit.
Now, there is no such a statement.
Thank you very much, sir.
Do we understand each other? You see, it's very important that there is the witness that did never say somebody will come and change their statement. He is testifying of the possibility.
Well, now,
so just be careful, because you'll be arguing, and I want you to be alert to this issue so that when we argue, the witness is not there. So this witness hasn't testified that somebody will come.
Okay.
He is testifying that there is that possibility.
Okay.
So and that, when you put to him that he's speculating, you are free and all. But to say that somebody is coming when it's not what he's saying, it's not fair to him.
Thank you for correction, my lordship. I would just rephrase. You testified as a possibility, sir.
That's correct.
But that is just a possibility. You don't know what will happen in future.
You are correct.
There's also the possibility that indeed they will come and stick to the story what they have told the ACC. Is
that's
that
correct.
So?
That's correct.
So before I move on to the personal circumstances of applicant number 6, there's one particular issue that I want.
Now, are you questioning him on applicant number 5 or 6?
I've the personal circumstances of and the reason for opposing I've dealt with when it comes to applicant number 5.
Oh. Are you moving on to number 6 now?
Indeed. Okay. But before I move to applicant number 6, mm-hmm. it's also relevant to applicant number 5. It's a document that has been introduced, more particular Z46. So do you have such a document, or can I provide you with a copy there?
You can just give me the page.
I will do so. 4-6. So what document is that in front of you?
Is an authorization letter.
What is the date?
It's 14 October 2019.
What is of interest for me in this particular letter, more particular page 2, first paragraph, the Inspector General make reference to specific persons that are under investigation or by this letter should be investigated in terms of section 4, 5, and 6 of the Prevention of Organized Crime Act 29 of 2004. Is that so?
That's correct.
On this particular letter is the name of applicant number 5 and 6.
Their names are not there.
And you have also been at length cross-examined by senior counsel on behalf of applicant 1, 2, and 3. And you basically informed us, or you say that you have the authority to investigate cases when it comes to poker. Is that so?
Investigated as other offenses derived from the corrupt practices is what I have testified.
Now, sir, can you perhaps also then share with me on which section of the anti-corruption you rely?
I rely to section 3. To section 28,
okay.
And to section 31.
Section 3, 2, 28.
No. Section 3,
and
21, and 30.
Section 3, section 28, section 31.
Okay. So I will provide you now with a copy of the Act. One for you, one for the court. And I want you to draw your attention to more particular what is of interest for me is that Chapter 3, Investigations and Corrupt Practice, number 18. And I refer you to number 3 of that 18 sub 3. You got it. Second page.
Yes.
So I want
sorry, let me just the pages that you have given is chapter 3 and not section 3. And it's chapter 3 starting section 17, 18.
Hello. Unfortunately, we have moved on. The question has been posed, maybe during the time of the exchange of documents. Oh, okay. I've made reference to number 18.
Oh, sorry. Then repeat if I've missed anything.
It's the chapter number 3, investigations of corrupt practice. Is that the heading?
Yes, correct.
Now I draw your attention to number 18, second page, number 3. You got that?
Yes, correct.
Can you please read that for me into the record?
You say if the commission decides that an investigation in relation to the allegation is warranted on reasonable grounds, report it.
No, but sir, this is prior to that. This section deals more particularly during the course of the investigation. Should be carried out by the commission or whether the allegations should be. Not after you have done.
I'm sorry to interrupt. Three again.
In total.
Yeah.
If the commission decides.
You read it or him read
he
it?
He read it.
Okay, ask him to read it again.
Can you please read it for us again?
If the commission decides that an investigation in relation to the allegation is warranted on reasonable grounds, it must decide whether the investigation should be carried out by the commission or whether the allegation should be referred to another appropriate authority for investigation or action.
Okay. And then I ask you a question. Was this done in this particular instance?
And that
exactly.
Paragraph, sorry, Mr.
What I want you to clarify. There are. You see, these things are important for purposes of my decision making. There are. If the commission decides to investigate in relation to the allegation, that an investigation in relation to the allegation is warranted on risk, it must decide whether the investigation should be. So there are a number of issues that the commission must take a decision upon. So what is it that you are asking whether the commission has decided?
Let me clarify. Let me deal with that. During the course of your investigation, you come across that some of the charges or the information that...
Are you changing the question?
No. Okay. I just want to give him... Not at all, my lord.
No.
During the course of your investigation, if you come across that some of these crimes, more particular, is poker-related and not specific corruption.
My lord... Before I answer that question, I think the councillor should read the heading on top of that section. Then he will understand.
Okay. So we already read the chapter 3, investigations of corrupt practice.
I said read the heading on top of section 18.
Who's in the box now?
Because, my lord, I explained to him at which time such a decision has to be made. I said it should be...
I made it as a joke, but it's very... You see, I don't want this debate. I want you to answer questions. And when these issues go, it's a debate, and it loses the essence of what cross-examination is all about. So just answer the question. If it doesn't clarify, you say your question is not clear or refuse to answer. Don't engage in the debate.
No.
Yes,
sir,
my lord.
Sir, if that power, or if you've been authorized, according to you, to investigate, why have the Inspector General then issued this letter, 14 October 2019, Z46, if that power, according to you, was already vested in you?
Maybe I don't know how to answer your question. Because the section that you are referring to me, it seems you also don't understand what it means. Really, I cannot give you that answer.
Okay. But can you try to answer my question? If the powers was vested in you already, what was the purpose of the Inspector General to, by way of this letter, 14 October, in terms of Section 83 of the POCA Act, nominate, provide names in writing of persons.
Because there were assets involved that we have identified, and the police have to follow up on such assets. Since they are having the power to seize those assets.
We can move on, we will argue that point in due course. So now let me place then the personal circumstances of applicant number 6 in order for you to comment. Applicant number 6 testify before this court that he is married, he has children, and he reside in Commerzdal, more particular to Earth 6411 Commerzdal. Would you deny that?
I will not deny that.
He also testified that at the time of his arrest that he was a member of the city police.
I'm not disputing that.
So according to your knowledge and your investigation, is he still a member of the Namibian police?
City police.
I beg your pardon? Of the city police.
I do not investigate such.
But you have made a sweeping statement and said that he's unemployed, sir, during the course of your evidence in chief. So you cannot make a statement if you have not investigated. Is that so, sir?
I don't know whether I did say that they are unemployed. I cannot recall such unless maybe to be guided.
May I put it to you that and such documents have been provided to this honourable court in the bundle of the applicant number 6. That is currently still employed with the city police, but is suspended, sir, without salary. So I will provide you with a letter of city. That is also before this court already, in order for you to verify. There's the letter. So what is the heading of the letter?
So notice of suspension.
What is the date of that letter?
It's 20 January 2021.
And the later part of that particular letter, I think the last paragraph, what is the contents there?
The last paragraph is saying, you are further notified that in respect of the period of your suspension, you are not entitled to any basic wage or benefits as prescribed by Regulation 24. Subsection 4 of the said regulations.
And does it also make reference to whether or not you would receive a salary on the next page, sir?
It reads as follows. Furthermore, you are instructed to avail all municipal assets issued to you, including your appointment certificate, uniform pieces, etc., with immediate effect. It was number one. Not to exercise any powers, functions, authority, and authority vested in you as a member, but continue to be subject to the same discipline and penalties as if you have not been suspended.
According to you, what is your understanding of the last few sentences that you read, sir?
What I understand, is that he is not allowed to exercise any powers as a police, city police member.
But he must adhere to the regulations. And is that so?
To?
But is must he adhere to the regulation of the city police?
That's correct, yes.
So which means that he has been suspended without any salary. Is that so, sir?
Yes, that's correct.
He also testified, applicant number 6, that is a Namibian citizen, sir. Would you dispute that?
I'm not disputing that.
He also testified that his family ties, his root, is in Namibia, sir. Would you deny that?
I'm not denying that.
He also testified that one of his children is attending school and is responsible. We must make a contribution to the school development fund. Would you dispute that, sir?
I'm not disputing that.
Sir, can you also inform this honorable court whether or not, according to your knowledge, that you have been requested by city police in order to come to the office to be interviewed?
I'm not aware of such.
You testify and you have not been disputed that the first time that you have been making himself available was on the 13th of July, 2020.
Sir, Mr. Engelbrecht, before you continue, did you put to the witness now that Mr. Mapopi testified that he has been requested to go to the office to be interviewed?
Did? Yes, my lord.
I can't recall that evidence.
Yes, I'm aware.
Do you know the first time or how many occasions?
I don't know at how many occasions and which time, but I know he was being dealt with by Olifield and Mr. Klute.
You testify and it have not been disputed by the state, but 2020. Would you dispute that?
I'm not disputing that.
Do you know the date of the arrest of applicant number 6?
It was the same as application number 5, applicant number 5.
My Lord, the State Council indicate to me it's apparently a convenient time for us to break.
Okay. We will take a break until 2:15.
As the court pleases.
Court will rise.
Court rise.